Hi, hello there, and first of all, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year's to all of you. So back at it again. I know I've called this kind of like a hangover thing. Oh, my phone just went off. I'm just gonna close that. I called this a hangover thing, and I guess it is. But come on. Sorry about that. Even though the hangovers I'm having is not that severe, you know, I have a small kid and stuff like that. So basically, I didn't go all in yesterday. But that's okay also. Today we're gonna tie. I'm gonna tie three flies. I was a bit. I was a bit. Excited about and thinking about what I was going to do. So today I'm going to do three things. All of them are things that I've not done, I've not tested them out before. So it's going to be new stuff. And that's probably why I'm going to call it a hangover freestyle fly tying, because basically this is something that will kind of evolve as we go along. First off, I'm going to do a tube fly. I'm going to do a fly that I'm going to use for the Danish salmon on the starting of the season. So a fairly large sunray shadow type of fly that's called the HKA sunray, a bit modified with a bunch of hairs and stuff like that. After that, we're going to do a pike fly, something along the lines of this, a fairly easy pike fly, but I'm going to do it on a hook today. Fairly simple pike fly on a hook. And then finally, I'm going to do something with this. I'm going to make a small bait fish using only sinew laser dubbing and some eyes. So basically that's it, and today it's probably going to be a bit more than 1 hour. I'm hoping we'll end on something like 1.5 hour, something like that. So feel free to tune in anytime you like, and if my rantings annoy you, then well, you're free to leave as well. So first off, all I want to do now is to check if the audio is okay. I can hear some firecrackers and stuff like that outside, and also if the image quality is okay. So I have these two camera setups as usual. This is the one on the tube fly, and the other one here where you can see where I can show materials a bit more and stuff like that. So I'm just gonna check the chat here to see if you think everything is okay. Oh, and thank you all for tuning in and all the. All the Happy New Year's wishes. Thank you a lot for those. Okay. The pictures and the sound are not in sync, I hear. Well, basically, I think what can happen is there can be some latency. I don't know if that's on your devices only or if it's because of my connection, but I have the best internet connection I could get for where I live. So if it's a bit out of sync, I apologize, but well, basically that's something probably you'll have to live with. Well, first off, as I said, this is going to be something this is going to be an HKA summary, and if it should be the real HKA sunray, I should use Mylar tubing and stuff like that. But I have something, and the HKA, it stands for Henrik Kasau Andersen, which is the inventor of this fly. And this is a tremendous, tremendous cool fly. This is the salmon fly that I caught the most salmon on in, well, in my entire life. That's not saying too much, but I've used this a lot in Iceland this year, and I've made a video about this, and it's simply just outfished anything I ever tried. So a very good fly, and today I'm going to tie one that I've modified a bit in order to be able to use this for the fishing in the river in a Danish river called Stone. If you translate that, it's going to be Big River. So basically, it's Big River. First of all, I've taken one of these FutureFly tubes here, and I've just melted the end. And what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna add some US tubes, and these are gold, but these are also tungsten because when you fish the river I fish, it's very deep, and you need to get down. So I simply add three of these in order to give this some weight, and this is gonna be kind of like the entire body. Then I take my tying thread here, and then I'm gonna tie all the way up to there. But as you can see, I tie a bit in front as well, and that's because this fly is gonna have an eye. Maybe I should just get one. I think I have one in white somewhere. I think I have one in white somewhere. See, this is a lot of flies here, as you probably can see. I thought I saw one just the other day. Yeah, there it is. This is one of the ones that actually I caught a lot of fish on in Iceland. So this has been a bit mangled. As you can see, it has an eye up in front, and this is just a silver white variation of this. But the reason why I'm tying this in yellow is because yellow is one of the favorite colors of all time to the River Storo. So basically, I need a bit of space up here in order to make my head and to make my head to have room for the eyes. So simply, I tie all the way up to these US tubes in order to make them stay where they are. But basically, I'm going to tie the rest of the fly a bit further down here. Right, so. Like that. The eyes there. Okay. As I said, yellow is a very popular color in the River Storo, and also the color that I caught my... No, actually, I caught one on the white last year, but also one on a fly that's called the Munker. Now we've done that, I'm going to take some Marble Fox. No Andy Pandy fly tying. I'm not using a DSLR. I'm using two different webcams. The DSLR it does not work optimal, because you have to have a lot of different programs in order to set it up and stuff like that, and it really destroys the quality. The more different things you have to put these the video through, the more the quality it's at the expense of the quality. So I've taken a bundle of white marble yellow marble fox here, and I'm gonna take out some of this very coarse rough fur down here, because you want this to be. And this is going to be a fly for the early season, so it's going to be a big fly, a fairly big fly, but it's also going to be a fairly, not too bulky a fly, because I want this to get down and to fish deep. And in order to do that, you don't want the profile of your fly to be too wide, too big, because if you do that, then the fly will have difficulty getting down. So basically, I take this bundle here, and I tie it here. And white thread is preferable, because the white thread here will look better in the head, because we're doing the head with the UV glue. So basically like that. And then I'm gonna use some flesh. I hope you can see the wing here. I'm gonna use some crystal flesh for this. I see that the lighting is US tubes. It's something from Futurefly. Yeah, I'll send you a link here. You can see all the different tube stuff here in the chat. Oh, and Happy New Year to all of you. Okay, continuing. Is this wing what I want it to be? Yeah, that's okay. I guess that's okay. Good. Okay. So next up is I'm going to take some flesh here, and I'm going to add this here, because if I add it on top of the wing, I'm going to add a bit on top of the wing as well, but I'm just going to have a few strands in here in order for them to be easier for the fish to see down from below, from underneath. And this is fluorescent flesh, this is fluorescent ascent dubbing from Hedron. Cool, not dubbing of course, but flesh, cool flesh, and I like this ascent dubbing. Some of you might know it as crystal flesh, but well, basically, the original stuff is this, the ascent flesh. Just four strands or so of this, like that. Cutting that off. I feel a bit rusty, even though I know that probably I didn't go all in yesterday with the beers and stuff like that, but I still feel a bit rusty. So, you must bear with me with my with if my tying is well a bit shaky, let's say, let's put it that way. Okay. Yeah, I'm from Denmark. So I take some this is black black marble fox. The quality here is very nice. I like the stuff from Future Fly. Basically this fly is tied almost exclusively of stuff from Future Fly. I like that company a lot. There's a lot of especially from Denmark, a lot of very nice tube manufacturers. For some reason we have two major in Denmark, the Pro Sports Fisher and the Future Fly, and both are very nice, very nice. Both have very nice materials, and their systems are very nice, both of them. I tend to move a bit back and forth between the two different, depending on what I want to tie and what I want to use. As you can see here, I'm simply just pulling a bit. I can maybe show you that better here. I have, as you can see, the quality of this is astounding. It really is a big patch of hairs. So basically I'm taking this long wing here, and I'm just pulling some of this a bit woolly stuff in the bottom here out, because I want the wing to be kind of uniform. Like so. Switch back. And of course I want my black wing to be longer than the yellow one. And I really must say that this fly simply was just unbelievable on in Iceland. I was fishing mainly with the white variation of this fly there, but the yellow one, I had a friend who fished with the yellow one, and that was good also. But really these sunray types of flies are just awesome, because they're fairly easy to tie, and they just fish so very well. Like so. How does that look? I think that looks actually pretty okay. And what you can do, if you like that, I can't find my scalpel now, but you can cut these hairs off with a scalpel in order to make the finish out here more the cut more clean. Like this. See, it's not a difficult fly. I'm gonna take a few strands of flesh more now. Just gonna see here. Lighting is fine. Tie on, my friend. I will. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to just ask away in the chat. I will try to keep up with that as good as I can. But you know, there's a lot going on, and well, yeah, it is the 1st of January, yeah. It got a bit late yesterday. Not too much. I had some very nice friends over whom also have kids, and it was really nice. I must say, at about 10, which is the normal time where you know the kids are asleep and I have to go to bed, I was very tired. But you know, I fought through it, and oh, I saw the new year and all the fireworks. That's something I've done every year, but you know, like that, just a bit more flash here. I'm looking forward to the 16th of April. Is it? Yeah, it is the 16th of April. If I'm wrong about that, you please feel free to comment. I'm pretty sure it's the 16th of April. So I'm just gonna use some tying thread like that. So, and the final touch here is I'm gonna take. I was thinking about adding some rubber legs, but I think that will. I don't think that will look nice on this fly. I'm gonna add some yellow. A yellow grizzly feather to the sides of this, because that really looks cool. I'm not sure if you would say that this feature will actually make this fly that much more efficient, but it really gives it a cool look. So I'm gonna add one. I need to turn the fly now to lay it on the side in order for get to get this in the right position. But I hope you can see what I'm doing. So basically, where the yellow and the black wing meet, I'm gonna add a grizzly feather, like that. So it's gonna be kind of like the sides, kind of not a jungle cock, but you know, kind of like the same effect as a jungle cock feather. And that you gotta love that. You gotta love that. That simply just adds, it adds, what is the right word? I don't know the right word, but in Danish I would say it adds credibility. It adds credibility, you could probably say. And authenticity. It just, it just looks deadly now. It just looks even more deadly than before. And if you have flies in your box that looks deadly, then more often than not, those are the flies that you will pick, and those are also the flies that you will fish with the most efficiently, because you know that what you have on your leader is something that you believe in, something that you trust, something that you think works. And if you're fishing with flies that you are certain work, then you fish more efficiently, and you pay more attention to details. And if you pay more attention to details, you will catch more fish, definitely. Yeah, it looks like the lateral line as well. Okay. So basically, that's about it. Oh, did I mess it up now? Oh, I did not, did I? A little. Oh, crap. I had accidentally tied on top of the feather here, and that's the kind of mistakes you make on a day like this. Is that okay? Yeah, that's okay. Gonna make a whip finish here, just a small one. Because I'm gonna add a lot of glue. Ah, now I did it again, god damn it. This is a bit annoying. It's there. It's fine. Cut off the thread here. And then we need to add the eyes in order to make the head of this fly. And I'm a bit fearful that I might accidentally have made this head a bit too big in order for me to get the shape of the rest of this completely correct. I'm gonna need these eyes. I'm gonna need my UV light. And if you haven't gotten one of these, then I urge you to get them. I found these directly from the manufacturer, so I sell these very, very cheap. I sell them less than 10 euros, less than 10 euros, US dollars as well, which is a very, very nice price. Most other places I've seen them, they're about 25 or something like that, 22, 25, something like that, 25, euros. So a good price for this, and this is one of the best. If you're not into the really, really big, very expensive one, then this without a doubt is the best UV torch you can get your hands on. So, back to tying the fly. What is the advantage of using tube flies? Oh, I can tell you a lot about that, Moritz. First of all, when you're using tube flies, you if you accidentally, let's say, catch a stone, I'm gonna do that here like this. If you accidentally, if you're using, let's say, a double hook or something like that, and you hit a rock, then your fly is completely busted. The fly is useless, and you have to simply to discard the entire fly. You don't have that problem with tube flies. If the hook is busted, let's say for a snag in the bottom, which is the case most often where I fish, and you have to pull it free, then you simply just discard the hook, and your fly is still good to go. So you will have flies that last a lot longer because of this. Also, there's a lot of different stuff you can do with tube flies that I really, really like. There's kind of like a million, trillion different nice add-ons and your crazy stuff you can add to these simply in order to make them fish more perfect. If you can see, If you can see here, this is just a full tray of just, you know, bling and different cones and stuff like that that will fit on here and will make your flies fish more efficiently. So basically you have a lot of more options and I really like that, and you can decide from what type of hook you want in, and also you can make a fairly large fly like this, and without it having to have an insanely heavy shank, let's say that. So there is a lot of advantages with the two flies, and I've switched completely, and for salmon and sea trout I fish only tube fly now, and also I'm switching more and more to tube flies on the fishing on the coast and stuff like that, and also for pike. So there is a lot of advantages with the tube fly. I've talked a lot. Now I think it's time to get just a bit of this. I hope my rantings are okay, and that my English is understandable as well. You know, it is the 1st of January and all that. Well, cheers. This is only Coke. So, back to this. So I'm going to take some of this UV glue here. I don't know if that's the right precision for everything. I think it is. And then I'm going to add just a very, very tiny amount of UV glue here, just to have something that the eye can attach to and can be stuck in, like that. Then I take my torch here. I don't know if you can probably see it better in that angle. And then I do the exact same on the other side here. Also, when you're using this UV glue here on the fly, the head will be very, very, very strong. So you don't need to worry about varnish and stuff like that. There, and these heads are also fluorescent. And then basically what I do now is I make the rest of the head with the UV glue here. And what you want to do when you use the UV glue is simply to just take baby steps. Just add a bit of glue, use the light. Then a bit more glue, use the light, a bit more glue, use the light, and stuff like that, because you can make a very nice head in that way. But if you use too much at one go, then odds are you will get something that is, well, not very, it probably will be fishing, okay, but it's not going to be pretty. And well, if you've taken a lot of time and you use some hackles for the sides of the fly and stuff like that, then well, it's nice to have flies that also look good. At least I think so. And the flies, and I know that when I'm standing there on the bank, deciding what fly I will fish with this day, then of course the one I pick first is always the one that looks the best. And well, basically, I think that is because, you know, like in the old days where you have to tie it, where people tied all these insanely difficult and very, very weird looking classic, beautiful classic patterns, they were tying these because the salmon was the king, and only the best was good enough for the king. So you know, of course you had to have these ridiculously expensive, hard to come by feathers and stuff like that, because the more of that stuff you added to the fly, the more of that you had, the better it would be, because you were fishing for the king. And the king wanted bling, the king wanted all that crazy stuff, you know, so, well, basically. And then some of that still is around, I think, because, well, basically, salmon is king. There's a lot of very, very nice fish, of course, to fish for, and I love fishing for pike, and I love trout, and I love all that. And I love salmon, and I would not say that, you know, one species is better than others, but there's just something, like Hugh Falgus once said that, you know, it's strange, but you know, every single time I write salmon, I am doing it with a capital S. And I think that's kind of says a lot, you know, because salmon is special, and salmon deserves nice things. So they're getting that. Basically, this is pretty basic fly, but this is gonna be kind of like, I'm not sure if this is the exact one I'm gonna use on the first day of the fishing, but it could be. This is definitely gonna be how I'm gonna be using it, and this is gonna be the pattern that I'll be using for the for the salmon in the rivers in April in Denmark. Well, the setup for these are not that difficult. I'm just gonna grab one to show you. Basically, depending on what type of situation and what you want to do, this is how you do it. Just gonna pull this off. Now you see this is done. So I'm taking here, and then I'm cutting off the tube as close to the head as possible. And I'm actually very, very pleased with this fly. And then I'm taking my glue here, and simply just melting here, so I get this small kind of like column up here. I think it's called column. And then the fly is done. Of course, I could have chosen to ha added some more of this tube sticking out here in the back, but it's not necessary for salmon. But basically, what you do is you put your line through. Do I have a line somewhere? I do. I'm gonna show you. So a lot of you have not seen these tube flies before. So I have my line here, and basically I simply just put it through the tube. Ugh, come on. This is 0.16, so it's probably not what I would use for salmon. Basically, there you have it. So I have the line coming out of the tube here, and what I do is I take one of these, and these are called swing tubes, and they are truly, truly awesome. I simply put the line through one of these as well. Then I take my triple hook. If I use a triple hook, you could use a double or a single, depending on what you're allowed to in your stream and stuff like that. And I simply tie a knot. And then what I do is I take this here, and I pull the hook into this swing tube, like so, because this allows the hook to be centered, but also will ensure that my knot is not in any danger. And simply I fish it like this. So there you have it, a nice triple hook here in the fly, and the fly, because it's not attached to the, it's not fastened on the hook, will have a lot of movement. It will move very, very freely, and really, really look nice in the water. And if you have any damage to the hook, simply just replace it and stuff will go crazy. So and really, really, that's really, really why I'm so fond of these I'm so fond of these tube flies. And if you haven't tried tube flies out, then I urge you to do so for your salmon and for your sea trout and for, yeah, basically for a lot of different things. And this fly, it's easy, it's relatively fast to tie, and the eyes really, really, I think, make a difference. So and when you see this in the water, you are completely convinced. And I'm very happy that great many thanks to Henrik Kassow for showing me this fly. Really, really cool stuff. Okay. Well, if you look at the time now, you will see that I'm actually pretty spot on. That was 1.5 hour for the first one. Well, Duncan, you can use the silicone, but and I've used that a long time, but I've turned away from that because the swing tubes are simply better. If you use the silicone, you will have the hook the hook connection. The hook will being fixated on the fly, which will make the fly a lot more still in the water. It will not have the same movement because it's not hanging free. So I use the silicone simply also because when you're fishing in, let's say, fishing with very heavy sinking lines, and then you can take your double hook and turn it upside down so you won't get as many snags and stuff like that. That's a pretty cool thing. So that's why I used silicone for a long time. But since I saw these swing tubes, I must say I am truly, truly amazed at how cool they really are. They are without a doubt the best thing that happened to Two Flies in, yeah, forever. This opens up a completely new avenue and revolutionized the way that you can use Two Flies, because the problem before was that your Two Flies, if you had it in the silicone, would be in the hook guide, would be fixated and lose a lot of life. They don't do that because they're hanging free now. The flies are hanging free on the line and will move kind of like if you have a hook fly on a hook that's tied in a loop knot instead of the regular knot. So there is a lot of difference. Yeah, it's going to be a pike fly now. Just don't you worry. A bit impatient there, Gary. And also, if you have any questions, you know, ask away, and I'll try to answer them as good as I can. Well, moving on. I think it's about time. As I said, I'm going to tie a fairly easy pike fly now, and we're going to use mainly three materials: the good old faithful bucktail, which is something you should never leave home without. Some two different types of standard flesh boot, red and then this awesome color. This is the speckled silver, really nice stuff. I'm gonna do this on a hook today. So I have one here that is ready. I'm gonna tie these on the new Arix hooks, which is actually a hook that I've been involved in making the shape of and deciding how it should look. And of course, I'm using one of these that is without a bar, because, well, basically I like pike flies, and I love pike, and if you love pike, then I think it's nice to fish without the barts. How is that? Is that okay, or should I just? Is that okay? Jeppe, der kommer flere laksefluer, det gør der helt sikkert. Der kommer flere laksefluer, det bliver en blanding af både laks og havørred. So of course, Jeppe, there will be more salmon flies. Definitely. You know, I love salmon. Does this look okay? Before I move on, I would like to know if... So I'm guessing when you're just typing okay, that's because it's okay. Good. As you can see here, I've taken a 4.0 Bartless Arix light predator hook, and I've added a small tungsten bead in 4 millimeters, something like that, in order to give it a bit of weight. So I'm taking my the color of this bead is completely irrelevant because we're gonna add a head as well and stuff like that. So now I'm just taking my thread here and I'm starting, let's say, in the middle of the hook. It's not something that really matters a lot. Like that, and then I'm going to take a bundle of bucktail. But before I do, I think I need to have a bit more tying thread here. When you're tying on hooks, it's important that you have a very solid base of tying thread when you're tying down big bundles of stuff, because otherwise they will simply, you know, just turn around the hook, which will be fairly annoying, and your flies will not last very long, and well, basically, even though this is not a very expensive pike fly, it still is quite a lot more expensive than, let's say, tying an Adams or a Fretnik or something like that, a small dry fly, because the amount of materials is, of course, bigger. So I've taken a bundle of white bucktail here, and as I said before, I've not done this color combination, and I've not even done this fly on a hook before, so, you know, it's freestyle fly tying. It's frozen. Refresh your if it's frozen, try to refresh your browser. So I take this bundle of bucktail here, and I try to make sure that it's all the way around the hook before I clamp down, and then I do that. I'm gonna tie on top of this and really use some pressure here. Really use some force, and that's why also it's nice to have a good tying thread. This is a Future Fly tying thread that I like fairly much, like so. And as you can see, this here is not moving in any direction. It's where I placed it. like I want it to. Take all this bucktail here. And I point that backwards. Like so. Well, John, if are you talking about pikes? John Ress, are you talking Ressy? Ress, I don't know how that is pronounced. Are you talking about pikes, or are you talking in general for you know, tube flies versus hooked flies, or so? As you can see, I have this fairly large bundle of bucktail now. That's, you know, out in every which way, like that. Then I'm gonna take some of this red flesh here. I want this red flesh to not to be as much very big, so I'm taking a smaller bundle. Not that big a bundle. This is holographic Fleshaboo in the standard length, because I want this fly to be a fairly light fly, not too big, easy to cast, even for, let's say, a 7-weight, something like that. A good beginner's pike fly, you could call this. So basically, I'm taking a bundle like this, and then again I try to distribute this so it's all the way around, and so it's not too far back. So maybe this is gonna be kind of like 15 centimeters, something like that. So I have quite a lot that's sticking out in front here as well. And then again, try to distribute it all the way around. Like so. Oh, that looks nice. So as you can see, this will blend very nicely with the bucktail, and I will have flesh that is currently all the way around. Then I take a bigger bundle of this speckled Fleshaboo. We could call this the Little Red Riding Hood. That's a good name for this fly, I think. It's also one of the World of Warcraft buses, so basically it will be within the theme of I started with these types of flies. Here is the speckled silver here. So I take a larger bundle of this, like that. Cut that off all the way up to the end here, like so. And again, I simply just, in order to get this so it's not completely uniform, I simply take some of these and just pull them a bit out, so they're a bit shorter and a bit longer, depending on, yeah. So the ends is not completely uniform. Then I do exactly the same as I did with the red, and also the same length. Approximately the same length all the way around here, and then tie this down like so. Use some tying thread, and what we need to do is, now we need to get the thread all the way up to the front of this fly. As you can see, I have my tungsten bead up here, and I actually want to have my tungsten bead a bit further down, not completely up where the eye is, because I'm going to add a head here in a second. So what I'm going to do is like that. Oh, because I have my tungsten head inside here. And basically, you can do like this. And if you want this to stay where it's placed, that's kind of like a nice thing with pike flies. You can take your Sabagab and just glue away here. This will make everything strong and everything stay in place. Like this. Like so. I'm tying all the way up to the head here. To the eye. Where do we have the eye? Almost there, like so. Okay, I'm just gonna see here. I use tube flies mostly, yeah. But if it's just, you know, if you're a beginner, I think the hooked flies is easier, because the leaders and stuff like that is a bit more simple to start out with. So I think if you want to try something out, then a hooked fly is the easiest way to start. Simply because the leader is more easy to use and to try and to make and to apply. And also the hooked flies tend to be smaller, and in that regards they are easier to cast. But of course that's something you can decide for yourself depending on. I just took another bundle of bucktail, depending on type of fly of course you're tying. So as you can see, I did exactly the same as the first one. I have a nice bundle of bucktail here, and I'm going to tie that directly behind the tungsten bead here. I'm going to tie it again the same way I did the first time. So this is going to point forward, and it's going to be all the way around the hook. Again, use some turns of thread before you actually really, really tighten this, like so. So now you have a lot of different stuff sticking out in front here, and that's basically okay. I'm gonna do a whip finish now, like so. Like that. Cut off the thread here, and then for the grand finale, I'm gonna use one of these. These are the Flyman fish masks, and this is the 8 millimeter, 8.5 I think it is. But the 8 millimeter is nice I use the 10 millimeter for tubes and the 8 millimeter for hooks, because if you use a too large one of these for the hooks, then the head will simply become too big, and it will mess up the it will significantly drastically decrease the number of fish you will catch, because it will simply affect the hook gape, and the hook gape is the most important factor in how many fish you will actually hook. So you want as much hook gape as possible, and that's why this 8 millimeter is a nice size for a hook, but the 10 millimeter is nice for the tubes, because you will have the tube further back, and that it won't be a problem with the hook gape in regards to the same thing as with this one. So basically I take this, and then I use the head here. I use the head. You see here, I simply fold all of this back here in the natural way it's supposed to be, and then I take the head and I use the head to make all of this point backwards. Whoops, it came back off. Oh, the color combination here is truly, truly great. Because then I will still have a fairly bulky, fairly light fly now, and the head here will simply just keep everything in place, and I will have a fairly hollow fly that really, really looks nice. And in order for this to stay there, I think what I need to do here is simply just make a small bundle of tying thread up in front here. You could also just apply some super glue and stuff like that. I'm basically gonna do that. But you can also just use your. I have the UV glue right here, so I'm just gonna use that. But you can also, the safest way is simply to apply some tying thread. But this is the fastest way. We can move on then. This is a light, fairly bulky, very, very lively, very, very nice swimming fly that's fast, easy, and cheap to tie. And well, basically, what's not to like about a pike fly that has all those properties? The last thing we need is an eye, and I had one of those in the correct size just a second ago. Oh, eyes, where art thou? Always getting away, you know that feeling. Crap, show up, turn up eye. So I'll just get another one. I think I have some over here. That's one of the advantages of making these videos inside your own well, your own shop. So I'm taking these are frantic eyes in orange and silver in 8 millimeters, which is the size that fits this here, and a nice some nice eyes, and also some eyes I have a very, very nice price on in the shop. Again, because I simply just, you know, go directly to the source instead of buying them from distributors. It means I have to buy a lot of eyes, but you know, oh, I'm fine with that. Just gonna cut off the tag for it here, and then add the eye. You know, that actually looks kind of nice, don't you? Don't you agree? I'm gonna show you the complete fly in a second when I have the eye on the on the other side. Again, just add some super glue. Oh, UV glue, if you have that. UV glue is probably a bit more efficient for this, but add it to the groove of these Flyman fish skulls. They're nice, these Flyman fish skulls. I like them because they make it a lot easier to actually make your flies look very cool without having to mess about with too much epoxy and stuff like that. So, this one is coming for you. So see, fairly easy, fairly light, a very, very nice looking pike fly in all the right colors. And it looks a bit bulky now in the back part, as you can see from this angle. But that's actually okay. Well, because the head has taken a lot of has moved a lot of this the front part into making this quite thin, and then the back part it has not been, there's not been the same amount of pressure on the bucktail, so it will maybe look a bit strange when you tie it, but in the water this will look absolutely perfect, and this is a very cool imitation of, you could call it a bleeding roach or something like that. I'm gonna go with Little Red Riding Hood, definitely. Another World of Warcraft reference. Little Red Riding Hood. I think I'm gonna use this actually on Rügen. I'm going to Rügen in 3 weeks' time, something like that, to fish pike for, if the weather is okay, to fish pike for a weekend, 3 days. I'm really looking forward to getting some fishing time with pikes. I have not been fishing enough pike this past year. I've been fishing a lot of other stuff. Mainly salmon, but I've neglected the pike fishing a bit. I'm gonna do something about that in 2007. That's a promise. So basically there you have it. And as you can see with the time, it's actually a very fast fly to tie. So I could probably make even one more before the 13 minutes was up. David, I don't know the Telis Katsugianamos. I don't know him, but please send me a link to something. Yeah, Karazhan, exactly. Yeah, but Karazhan for the win. That was good times. That was good times. I remember how insanely overpowered that gear was compared to the 60 gear. Oh, it was just amazing. Just truly amazing. The first big patch. That was great fun. How about a video showing hook and trace setup for pike 2 flies? Well, John, I have exactly that several different places, but I'm going to show you here. If you see this link here, that is for different materials for pike leaders, and there are two different kits here. There are a kit for making leaders for hooked flies, and there is a kit for making leaders for two flies. And on both these with both these products, there is a complete video on exactly how to tie these. So the video is already there. So if you need some stuff to look up, simply just look at that link I just posted. No, I'm not gonna do the backflip. Not today, Duncan. I know the backflip one, you know. God damn it. But what would you rather? Would you rather have me die? have me die here than mean being able to, you know, perform more of these on a fairly regular basis, because maybe I'm not gonna die if I attempt to do the backflip, but I'm gonna hurt myself a lot. Maybe the video would go viral and maybe that would be worth it. I don't think it would, but you know, backflip, yeah, I saw that. I'm just gonna scroll a bit up here in the chat to see if I missed something. Ah, thank you, Mortis. Nice that you swung by as well to see this. Should we move on and do the next fly? I think we should. The next fly is going to be very, very much an experiment as well. That's gonna be something I'm gonna try to experiment a lot with. But yeah, you know, let's just give that a go. And it's also okay if this is not gonna last 1.5 hours. Then well, that's okay with me as well. I'm sweating a bit. These lights here are truly, truly insane. Even my coke is getting warm. But I think I'm pretty pleased with the performance so far, because I was a bit, you know, a bit afraid of what would actually. Well, I'm just gonna do something very, very quickly now, and if you're not planning on being tempted, then avert your eyes. Not gonna say anything more. I'm just gonna show you this. Not saying any more. It will be there soon. I have the only copy in Denmark. Okay, I know. So, the next fly I'm gonna do is gonna be an experiment. I'm gonna try to make one of the easiest, fastest baitfish patterns ever. And if it is as fast as I think, Then I'm gonna do a shrimp exactly the same also. So first of all, this is an A-Rex hook, and then I'm gonna take some, if I can find them, then I'm gonna take some chain bead eyes. These chain bead eyes are actually quite cool for a lot of things, and they're very, very inexpensive. Really, really works if you have a drain clock that, I don't know if it's called a drain clock, the thing that stops the drain, that you don't need the chain. You can simply just rip that off and you'll have a chain for tying flies. I remember doing that to quite a lot of different places where I was not coming back to again. Not a very good thing to do, but you know, when you're young and you don't have a lot of money, you get your fly tying material where you can. So basically, I'm gonna take, again, just a white thread here is nice. Basically, I'm gonna do a fairly solid base here until it is using a good way to tying wings. Yes, you can use wriggle tails on tube flies, Luke. I'm just gonna link, and just another thing here. This here. This here, John, is exactly how to tie. The link I just showed you is exactly how to make a leader and a rig for tube flies with wriggle tails. And wriggle tails are probably the most important, one of the best argument for using tube flies is that it's so easy to change. Change your tube fly and change different types of setups and rigs, fishing with wriggle tails or not, and stuff like that. So basically, one of the biggest arguments and one of the best arguments for using tube flies for a pike is the way you can diversify and simply just make a ton of different rigs that are usable for different situations. And that's very important, because you can add a different weight system and you can pull your hook further back into the wing if it's a larger fly and stuff like that. So the key to tube flies for pike is that you have a lot more options when it comes to how you want to have your hook, basically. And that's, well, probably the most important thing. Well, back to this one. So, I'm taking these chain eyes, and I'm simply just, tying in eights here. This should probably be a bit further back. Just gonna move them a bit further back if I can, like so. I want a bit of room up in front here. So as you can see, I'm basically tying in eights. And what you want to do when you want to fasten these correctly is you want to tie underneath the eyes. So you're tying between the eyes and the hook, because if you do that, then you will pull tight on these turns you've made around the fly, and this will make the eye the eyes stick where you place them. Like so. Then basically I'm gonna move further down here, like so. You can add a bit of weight to this fly. You can add a bit of non-lead wire or lead wire, depending on what country you're in and what you have available. The Danish legislation is not allowing you to use lead, so I'm using non-lead here. But I want this to have a bit more weight to it, because I'm going to use a lot of materials that will not sink very easily. And even though they are made of metal, these bead eyes, they're not that heavy. So basically like this. And now I'm gonna try to do something strange and something I've not done before. So bear with me. This is an experiment. I hope a live experiment, and I hope it works. I'm gonna take two different colors of sinew lasered up. First, I'm gonna take a white, and then I'm gonna take a gray. No, actually, I want to take only the gray for this very first one. Basically, what this laser dub is a fairly long fiber dubbing, very, very cool, but it's also blended with a lot of flash. So basically, you can take this and you can use this as a wing. So I take this and then I simply just pull it out, and then I have something like this. Does that make sense? It's about the length of a cigarette, and I simply just tie this on top of the hook, like so. I simply just tie the bundle there on top of the hook. If you want, you can. Okay, like that. So I'm just tying the bundle here on top of the hook, like so. And then I'm pulling in both ends, so I have some. I'm gonna put this to the side because I'm gonna use this later. Then I'm gonna take a bundle of white, exactly the same way as before. So I have this kind of this, and I'm gonna put this onto the thread like this, so I can pull it up and have it exactly the same position as the gray one, only this is gonna be underneath the hook. And I'm gonna try to, like so. Then I'm folding everything of this backwards, and it's gonna be a bit difficult with the white, because I'm gonna have to get the white. Underneath the hook here, like so. Then I'm taking my tying thread and tying a bit further up here. So now you have a dark gray top and a white lower part. Like this. And then I'm gonna repeat that same thing two or three more times up the hook here, building a body for a bait fish, like so. That was the gray. This is a very, very simple way of making a quite cool looking bait fish. That. Again, I have to get those white stuff on both sides of the hook. That's a bit annoying. I'm gonna tie on top of this on the non-lead wire here. Are you there, people? I can't see anything happening in the chat. Well, I hope you are. It looks like you are with me still. Like so. Again, gonna take some gray here. And then some white. This is actually quite fun. And this is because the Senyu laser really, really is a nice material. And one of the only materials I've come across that you can actually do this with. Ah, god damn it. You can see the lead wire. That's not something I intend to have happen. Like this. And if it's not enough dubbing, you can simply just add some more, because basically before we're done with this, we can simply pull out a lot of this dubbing and we can just put it over in the pile over here and then use it for the next fly. So it's not wasted, even though you use quite a lot of dubbing for this. But the dubbing that you pull off, you can simply take and use for the next fly. Like so. I'm gonna do same thing with the white here. And there is quite a lot of really, really an astounding amount of dubbing in these packages. Simply also because I think that this is something that a lot of people are doing for big ass streamers. Doing flies like this, where this Senyu dubbing is almost exclusively the thing that the hits. Oh, I can see my eyes are not completely stuck there. Just gonna add a bit of super glue to the eyes so they will stay in place. Stay like that, and now I think for the final. Front of this, I'm gonna go and, yeah, why not? Let's just make it completely crazy and just make it out of red dubbing, the last part here. So take a bundle on top again, like that, and then I'm gonna take a bundle underneath. This really looks relatively quite insane. Like that. Yeah, this is an experiment, but I think this is gonna actually, if I do the rest of this right, then this is gonna look amazing. And you know, this has really, really not taking very long to do. So basically like that. And now I'm simply gonna take a lot of this gray that is too much, you can see, and then I'm gonna put this over to the side. The same thing with the white here. I'm gonna pull a lot of this out because it's gonna be too much dubbing. You could also have done this whilst you were tying, that probably would have been smarter. And then you can take this out and you can simply just cut with your scissors and make this. Maybe it's probably is easier to have it in the vise than in your hands. It is easier to have it in the vise. Oh, this can go very wrong, but it can also be pretty cool, I think. And then take a fairly large pair of scissors here, and then trim it so it tapers. If you can do that the right way, then this is gonna be cool. And if you cannot, as it looks like I not have done here, then it's gonna be a disaster. This is not gonna be as cool as I thought it would be. think I can still save this, probably. You can do this with other types of dubbing as well, with SLF dubbing, for instance. I think I've seen this done with, but I just thought, but really, really, what I wanted to show with this was that the Sinew laser dubbing truly is a cool dubbing for making all sorts of different stuff. And I simply, what I've done here is I've simply added too much dubbing to this baitfish. It still can salvage this, so it's going to be a fly that definitely will fish and catch some fish, but it's not going to be as cool as I intended it to be. Does that make sense? Yeah, it's a cutthroat roach, yeah. But you can see, really, really, you can do a lot of different stuff with the dubbing, and you can make a complete, maybe even a game changers kind of fly with this. And really, really, I like the way that you can manipulate the dubbing here into something. Ah, you know, it's okay, this one. It's not completely smashed, completely useless, but it's not as cool as I thought it would be. And that's probably because I simply trimmed it too much. If you take more care whilst tying these to place, and you can see some of the lead wire on your side as well. You cannot on my side, but you can on your side. You can actually create kind of a very cool small bait fish very, very fast and very easily. But you know, coho and king salmon in Michigan, sea in US, no, sorry. Matt, you want something more now. I'm not sure if I have any more in me this evening. I am a bit tired now. I must be honest about that. But you know, my plan is to, depending on how it goes, and I need to talk to a lot of people. I'm gonna practice on this, and then I'm gonna do something really, really kick-ass, something really, really badass with this Sinew laser dub for you, because this first test here was just an idea I had this afternoon, you know. Just woken up from my afternoon nap because I was tired from yesterday, and I thought of this, and I thought, you know, what's the worst thing that can happen? I did call this freestyle fly tying, so you know, let's try it out live and see how it goes. And you know, it's I think the idea is there, but it's just something I have to practice a bit on. But what I was saying in regards to your I'm gonna tie articulated, definitely. I've been experimenting a bit with those as well. With articulated stuff, I just need the right hooks, because I have been messing a bit around with articulated streamers, and I'm gonna do some of those for sure. I just don't have the correct hooks, but I'm gonna get all the right stuff for these flies in the shop as well, because this is a cool avenue, a cool branch of fly tying, and I'm gonna do more about that. Lucas, but in regards to what Mats is saying, then my goal is to continue making these live streams, but simply I cannot do them two times a week, because basically that's taking too much of a toll on my family and on me. I'm simply getting a bit stressed out of having to do this two nights a week. So basically what I'm thinking now is to do this every Thursday. Every Thursday at 8, at 20, but then only do one in English. I made a poll in the Danish Facebook group about how people would react if I simply just only did the English one, and a lot of people said that they would be okay, because basically there's not enough time in my schedule to do two, and you know, the lights here and stuff like that. It is actually. I'm having fun, of course. It's really cool, and it's cool that you tune in and you watch this. But also, it's not easy. It's not easy work. It's It's an effort, definitely, but one that I'm happy to do this because I think this is fun also, but it is an effort. So my plan is to do this every Thursday, and I'm still considering if it should be only in English or if it should be changed so every second Thursday it's in English, every second Thursday it's in Danish or something like that, or whatever I'll do. But for sure I'm gonna do something, and the format, the style of this is something that I really like, and something that I really wanna keep continue doing. So if you have some questions, then please feel free to throw them around. Otherwise, I simply just wanted to show you this. This is a link to all the new stuff that is in the shop. I've added a ton of new cool items over this over the Christmas holidays. A lot of cool stuff. So swing by and have a look at those. That's for, in English. I'm gonna do one in Danish. The link in Danish as well. Because a lot of Danes are looking, are joining here, I see. Oh crap, what happened there? The link th there is for the is for all the news in the shop in Danish. Game Changers rules. I've have not actually tried those. I've not actually tried those out on the waters. I've tied a few, but I've not actually had them in the waters. But I'd like to. I'm happy to hear that they work. I haven't fished streamers before. Well, Duncan, regarding the size on trout flies, then it depends on how big trout you want to catch. Because I had it in New Zealand. I had a trout that actually chased down and completely swallowed a fish. I would say was about 20, 32, 34 centimeters. But that trout in New Zealand was a monster. It was something, you know. Maybe 90 centimeters, something like that. One of the biggest brown trouts I ever saw, and that was just insane. But you know, even very as a, when I fish for fishing for trout in Iceland and stuff like that, you practically you can the bigger the fly, more often than not, if you're fishing streamers at least, then the bigger the fish you will catch. So. Well, Colin, if you want to make a living from tying flies, then I, probably you can. But what what you should do is, of course, you have to establish a name for yourself, in regards to this, and then you should specialize in tying something that is, well, absolutely astounding. You know, maybe tie some classic salmon flies or stuff like that, but quality flies will always be in demand. But the sheer number of flies you would have to tie in order to maintain a decent pay is probably quite insane. And also you'll probably lose the love of fly tying, or lose the will to tie that many flies, I think. I don't know. But Matt Flies, can you read my last comment? Matt, I'm just gonna look for your comment, Matt. Sorry, Matt. Matt Flies. In Denmark, this is 8 o'clock in the evening, and I cannot do them before this because basically, my key audience is gonna be Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Germany, England. I know there's a lot of so you'll simply have to watch these you'll simply have to watch these videos not live, but you know the videos is going to be online on the YouTube channel, so you'll have to watch them afterwards because, well, this is the time this is the time of day that makes sense to make them. I'm sorry to say. Hello, Sparta Fishing. Hello to you as well. What type of vise do you use? Well, Lucas, I'm using Renseti. Renseti is the way to go. And actually, this is the Master in the Black Edition. And you know, one of the things that was really a sign that I was not paying attention is you see this very scratch up here on this very, very nice black black finish. I made this just before starting this live session with my tube fly needle because I wasn't paying attention. So, you know, my very, very beloved, I love this vice, like, kind of like, it's probably one of the top three things I own that I love the most, that I own, you know, stuff I own, not people, not, you know, stuff I own. And I just made this horrible, horrible scratch on this beautiful, beautiful vice just now because I wasn't paying attention. Oh, the needle is this. And there are two different needles. This is the Sportfisher needle, which is the best needle for tube flies. But for big pike flies, you'll need something else. You'll need this. This is an Oymer tube fly needle. I'm just gonna show you. Yeah. You can find all the different stuff on my shop. All the different stuff on my shop. Well, basically, I think that's it for tonight. I'm gonna. Yeah, you're right about that. I'm gonna revisit this type of flies. After I've been practicing a bit and you know, tuned in on exactly how this is going to be. But otherwise, I'd like to thank you all and wish you all a happy new year. And I hope to see you back here again on Thursday evenings at the same time at 20. So thank you for watching and good luck with all the fish. Bye. I'm signing off.